Hello, I am the Script Doctor, and welcome to the channel. When I watch Chapter 6 of The Mandalorian, on the surface it looks good and feels great. We have a clear mission, new characters that get an introduction and allow us to understand who they are and what roles they'll play. We get a ticking clock, and we get a betrayal and a conflict. Yet, after watching this episode, a part of me in the back of my mind was telling me that something was wrong. It took some time to divorce my fan self from my critical self, and then it dawned on me. Chapter 6 has zero risk of failure for our hero. The context of this episode is that the Mandalorian is meeting up with his old mercenary crew to do a job. He gets introduced to the team he'll be working with. Here we get some unique introductions and a diverse set of characters, followed by the briefing that reveals that they'll be rescuing a prisoner from a Republic transport. This raises a red flag with our hero as he thinks it's a bad idea to break out a prisoner that was arrested as opposed to freeing someone caught by a rival syndicate. The team establishes that the transport is automated, piloted, and guarded by droids. And that raises a red flag with me, because that tells me, and the audience, that there won't be any moral conflict. You see, so far in the show, the Mandalorian has only killed people that one could argue are outside of the system. They are scoundrels, mercenaries, scavengers, Imperials, and other hunters. But when it comes to your average person, someone who is innocent in some regards, he is polite and protective. Here, we have a situation where a Republic transport is moving prisoners and there could be Republic guards aboard protecting the ship, and that would conflict with the Mandalorian and what we so far understand to be his code. Those guards would be innocent in his eyes, and if he was going to proceed with the jailbreak, he'd want to do so without taking anyone's life. But instead of giving us, the audience, that challenge and the Mandalorian that conflict, the writer decides to avoid it altogether and replace the crew with droids so there won't be any issue with the Mandalorian shooting up the place. The writer has technically made it easier for this team to do their job, which is a big no in writing. You don't ever want to make things easy for your characters. If things get easy for your characters, then the story gets boring. There must be a challenge and there must be a risk of failure. They almost get away with a conflict when after they have destroyed a few droids and made their way to the helm, they find a human pilot. The Mandalorian demonstrates his code by trying to have the pilot cooperate with his team, but he is killed by the Twi'lek and we're back where we started. Now, had they used this story beat on a wider scale, we would have had a great conflict for this show. Imagine, once the Mandalorian defeats the droids, a squad of Republic guards arrives. Our hero is caught between two choices. Kill the guards to complete the job and violate his code, or protect the guards, risk failing to complete the jailbreak, and lose everything. You want your audience to ask the question, how can our hero reconcile this conflict? Is there a way for him to do both? Could he use a flash grenade and blind the guards while trying to push his team to stay ahead of them as they break out their friend without killing anyone? Because this episode is played very safe, it feels more like another one of those filler episodes we've had before, instead of progressing the character or the plot of this story. However, unlike Chapter 4 and Chapter 5, there is a stronger set of new characters introduced with a definitive goal. Aside from a missed opportunity for conflict within the job, we're also missing a compelling reason for why the Mandalorian is here. In the last chapter, he gave up all the credits he took from Toro Calican to pay for his ship repairs, but in this week's episode, our hero needs money again. It raises the question as to why he didn't keep some of the money from Toro for himself. When watching Chapter 6, I feel like the story is starting a scene or two late, skipping some important information to frame this episode. While we do get introduced to a newer part of this show's world and given a goal, we're not quite given stakes or an urgency regarding the Mandalorian's position. Had the story started a little earlier, say when he was feeding the child, and comments on how their food supplies will only last a few more days and that he needs money to keep running, then we get a better understanding of his circumstances. If we saw a challenge for the Mandalorian seeking out work without drawing attention, and his last result was to contact his old mercenary buddy that he doesn't trust, we would then see some added tension with this episode. We would get a conflict with the Mandalorian's character, a choice he has to make. Work for these criminals and keep the kid and himself fed as they flee, or refuse the job and keep searching while on the run without the means to resupply their ship or resources. Conflict is the best fuel for your story. You want there to be stakes, urgencies, goals, and difficult choices driving the character's actions, especially when you have a really solid plot for an episode. Aside from the absence of urgency and potential risk of failure and conflict, Chapter 6 does the rest fairly well. Each character's introduction in this episode is unique and memorable. We get Ran, a mercenary with a sordid past who loves his job, trusts no one, and shares stories of the good old days. We get Mayfield, an ex-Imperial Triggerman with a chip on his shoulder, who's a little thin-skinned but plays the tough guy who seems to have a quip or joke at the ready. Next, we get Berg, your brute archetype, all muscle and no brains. He leaps before he thinks. Then we get a droid with an ego, similar to K2SO from Rogue One, boasts about his superiority, and shows little regard for lifeforms. Finally, we get Zian, the ex-girlfriend of our hero, who is a little bitter from their separation. She's unstable and impatient. These types of different characters are what writers are familiar with when it comes to adding diversity in their story. Each of these five have their own perspective about themselves and how to get the job done. We can also see from their introductions the potential for conflict when they start their mission. This is all excellent setup and exposition done in a way that isn't so direct to the viewer that it bores us. It's all woven into the characters through each of their own behavior and their overall shared goal. And when the mission starts, it is really well paced. It's a simple plot. Board the ship, find the prisoner, rescue the prisoner, escape. It's very easy to follow these objectives. What it does really well is show how each character's flaw ends up costing them an advantage and setting them further and further away from success without their actions feeling blatantly stupid. They trigger these setbacks by exploiting Berg's flaw first. He shoots a droid, triggering a response from the patrol. Berg is even told not to shoot at the droid by Mayfield, but he ignores him because, as a brute, he can't show weakness. This triggers an awesome set piece where we see our team, and most importantly, the Mandalorian, show off some skills and get them to the next stage. When they get to the control room and see a human pilot, we see Mayfield's flaw. He's not a good leader. The Mandalorian shows better leadership skills and a clear goal of not wanting to harm this innocent man. This goes back to what I mentioned earlier about choice and conflict. It is a good scene, with strong tension, but we only get it once. This tension should be felt throughout the entire mission. The scene ends with Zian's flaw of impatience and living on the edge. This flaw triggers a ticking clock, limiting the amount of time to succeed with their mission. Once they release their prisoner, they betray the Mandalorian and lock him in a cell. Now, how they managed to do this was rather weak in comparison to what we've seen on the Mandalorian so far. I think what is missing from his character is having a partner he can talk to and coordinate with so we can get a little more inside of his head. Had he established beforehand that he doesn't trust these people but needs to work with them for the sake of survival, it would give us that tiny bit of understanding that he's going to be on guard and probably play along with them until the inevitable betrayal. However, just because the Mandalorian succumbed to a poorly planned betrayal, it doesn't hamper him for the rest of the episode. This is both good and bad. The good is that he's captured and has to figure a way out. The bad is that it's done quickly and effortlessly. There is no trial and error. He is not really running out of time. Let's say Zian's comment about needing 5 minutes is accurate. Then we have a 15-minute window for the Mandalorian to escape and get his revenge. That's not a lot of time, but it doesn't matter nor does it raise the stakes if he escapes from the cell with enough time to spare to turn the tables on the crew. Don't get me wrong, how he escapes is quite clever. But the fact that, at best, the Mandalorian is in a cell for maybe a minute doesn't really give any weight to the situation. Him being thrown in a cell and escaping moments later is a literal revolving door approach. There should be tension because of this action. His efforts to escape should fail as time is running out. He should be concerned for the kid aboard his ship, but we get none of this. Instead, once the Mandalorian escapes, we get a cool set of scenes where he starts picking off one by one of his team. It's quick, it's fun, it's revenge. But it doesn't feel cathartic. There wasn't enough pressure on the other side to give these actions that yes factor. That intense, victorious feeling of justice and satisfaction. It's a little hollow. There is a nice touch at the end, where the Mandalorian plants the beacon on the prisoner as he leaves his friend's station, and we get a taste of how the New Republic operates in this galaxy, expanding on their duties and role overall. We see that they have advanced tracking and surveillance abilities. We also see that their forces strike first and don't ask questions. The last few shots in this episode opens up a world of discussion regarding the politics of the New Republic. The context being that three X-Wing fighters confirm a Republic beacon aboard a station. They see that a fighter is about to be launched, and instead of opening a channel and stating their intentions and inquiring about the Republic beacon, they open fire on the station and we presume destroy it. I find it really strange, because the situation from the Republic's point of view should be one of inquisition. Why is a Republic beacon on a private space station? This beacon should have an identifying element to it to warrant an attack squad. They probably know it should belong to a prison transport, so why are they shooting first and not asking questions? Do they not want the prisoner back? Would it not be of use for them to arrest those that broke the prisoner out? Why an execution without a trial? It's almost a similar behavior to a regime recently overthrown, but is it really that different? It's kind of dark. Since we know there will be a second season of The Mandalorian, I can only hope that they further explore the New Republic and how they operate in future stories. There are only 2 episodes left in this season, and I hope we get back on track to the story set up in the first and third episode. So far, the content we've been shown has been okay, but I want more. More focus on the main plot, more development of our main character. If this weren't a Star Wars show, I'd have been out by now. But never underestimate the power of brand recognition and association. It can keep things on life support for quite a while. Let's hope the writers take some risks and give this patient some life so they don't have to pull the plug. If you enjoyed this video, please like, share, and subscribe. If you have anything to add to this episode, please leave a comment below. Thank you for watching, and never forget, it all starts with the script.